Hello again, guys, and welcome back to another video. Today, this is going to be about the tracked vehicle version 4. So as many of you guys know, I made quite a few videos about version 3, which was a large tracked tank vehicle that I built like 1 or 2 years ago. And that was pretty cool, big engineering project for me. But I've actually been working on something new lately. So there are quite a few issues with the old track vehicles, such as not being able to drive properly on high traction surfaces such as concrete or asphalt. Because of the way the tracks are made, they derail really easily. And with this big battery I had in it, basically it was very difficult to get upstairs, which was one of the main things I wanted it to do. And on top of that, it was very large. So I decided to try my hand at designing a new and improved version. So this is going to be version 4. It's a SketchUp model now. I'm going to show you guys all the parts and everything, but I'm actually not going to build it. I might in the future, but definitely not right now because I don't have money for this. Some of the parts are a bit expensive. But yeah, I thought I would just make a video about this, show you guys what I've built virtually here, and maybe you can use the ideas for inspiration, or if you want to copy this or build something very similar, I'll leave this SketchUp world down in the description so you can download that and take a look for yourself, do build your own stuff. But yeah, we're gonna start with this. It's a model. It's got all the parts in it. Basically, I have a large selection of parts that I made myself. Most of them I made myself, so I'll quickly go through them. This is the lead acid battery. Here's the receiver and antenna for the RCDX6i controller. This is a camera dome for a security camera. This is a circular polarized antenna for the video system. Over here we have the video transmitter. This is a BEC. And this is the video camera. Over here we have a switch, and next to that we have this thing, which is a ball bearing, mounted ball bearing. Whoops. And over here we've got the Sabertooth 2x60 motor controller. Over here we've got some CIM motors with the gearbox, and here we have the gears. And then I think all the way over here we've got just the chassis with the ball bearings mounted. So yeah, not very complex. This one's actually smaller than the one I actually built in real life, which was the V3. This one's only about 0.5 meter long by, whoops, by about less than 0.5 meter. So it's pretty square if you include the tracks that are going to be there. And oh, there you go. So yeah, I'm going to go through the parts here and that I included and explain why I chose each one. So first of all, let's go to this document over here where I have the list of parts. This is the main electronics. So Sabertooth 2x60 dual motor speed controller. This is almost $200 from the robot marketplace, and that's what is right over here with the fan on it. This controls both of these CIM motors to drive this vehicle. So this is a lot more powerful than the one currently in my other vehicle, and this one can do 60 amps per motor continuous, 120 amps peak. These motors are stall current 133 amps, so it's a bit over, but they're really powerful, so they should rarely ever stall. And this has thermal and overcurrent protection, so even if it does go to 133 amps, it will not damage this. And this should keep it driving even if it's under high load. It should drive it very well. Next part over here is the 10 amp BEC. The issue with these Sabertooth motor controllers is that they don't have a large BEC power delivery, The one I have right now is only 1 amp max, the 2x25. This one, I'm not sure, it might be more, I think up to 5 maybe, but still, basically whenever you draw a lot of current, when you have powerful motors, the BEC voltage drops, and that can cause connection problems. So that's why it's always better to have a dedicated BEC for your receiver. So now it just connects to the power directly from the battery. And I think it's Castle Creations 10 amps, so yeah, very powerful. Definitely more than enough if you want to add servos or whatever. Voltage indicator, I haven't really implemented that into this model yet. As you can see, there's only a power switch, but this voltage indicator is really cheap, and it would be really cool to be able to see how much voltage the battery has. And CIM motors, these are from BaneBots, and they're pretty powerful. They're kind of cheap too, only $30 each. So they're actually a great option for this build, and you can see they're perfect size over here. What is expensive though is the gearbox. So this is also BaneBots gearbox. I chose this one 36:1. They're $140 each, so very expensive. And I actually have a chart over here where I have all the different gear ratios that they offer, all the way from 1:1 to 256:1. And then I've calculated the torque, RPM, the price, and then the RPM and torque for peak efficiency. So these three are the ones that I was considering: the 27:1, 36:1, and 48:1. And these ones have the highest torque that the gearbox allows. The gearbox is rated at 115 newton meters, and these are the three that sort of fit them. This one's a bit over, but that's all right. And then the respective RPMs. So this one's sort of a sweet spot, 100, it's about 130 RPM, and you can calculate the speed of your vehicle based on that, and quite a lot of torque too. But I could also choose to go with a bit higher speed and lower torque, or higher torque and lower speed. Although I think this would be a bit too slow, so I'd probably go with this one or this one over here for this particular vehicle. I can also link these documents in the description if you're interested. Alright, next, so we got the motor, the gearbox, and then here are the 3/4 inch flange mount bearings. These are also from the Robot Marketplace, and these ones go at the front over here. So the rear wheels are powered by the motors, front wheels are not powered, they're just floating on ball bearings. And the design of this vehicle, you can see with some weird shapes over here, these are supposed to be U-shaped pieces of aluminum. I actually designed this vehicle to be built with pieces of metal that I have, so it's not the prettiest thing. As you can see over here, there's some empty space because this piece I have isn't long enough, and I've basically built everything to spec based on the metals that I have. Although if I built this in the future, I would probably just use some proper length pieces and maybe make it look a bit more pretty. But yeah, so that's where those bearings go for the front gears. And next come the more expensive stuff. So that you can see a total price for all of those parts is about $600. Here is the track. So this is a new track design that I've been designing for a while, and it uses triple strand roller chain. So that's pretty cheap, $80 for 10 feet, and then some chain sprocket links, and then gears. So these are actually the most expensive part of this project. So this can be done with either 8 single gears like this for about $480, but I actually contacted a gear production company that makes custom gears to see if I could get a double gear. Instead of having to use 8 of these, I could just use 4 doubles, because the gear needs to go in the outside chains and leave the inside empty. And that actually was going to cost about $750, close to $800. So definitely the most expensive part of this is the gears, and that's why I'm not building this yet. But I basically put these into the model anyway. So you can see these, this would be the double gear. So you got one here, space on the inside, and the second gear. And these are a whole piece. Basically the same as a triplex sprocket for triplex chain, missing the center one. And that is because with this triple chain, there would be a bike tire going around, similar to my old tracks. And then that would be attached to the middle of this chain. And then the gears would go on the outside too. And that's how I would achieve a chain that is very strong with high grip from the bike tire. And that would not derail, because these are actually chains and gears. They're not meant to derail. And the triplex chain actually is very difficult to, has very little side wiggle. So that's why it would be ideal for this project. Yeah, I did not put the chains into this model yet, because that's going to take a while to do. I have to do all the links and then the bike tire on top. So I didn't complete that before making this video, but I think you can get a pretty good idea of what it would look like without the chains. And off to the next part. This is the FPV system. So it would have a camera on it to have first person view, just like regular FPV RC. And that way you can control it without actually seeing the robot. And with my current track vehicle V3, that's kind of difficult, because the camera I'm using has high latency since it's not a proper FPV system. And the vehicle is very big, so it barely fits through a door, and that makes it very difficult to align when you're controlling it from a tiny camera like this on board. It's very difficult to actually see where you're going. So having one of these proper FPV cameras would help. 900 megahertz, 1.5 watt transmitter, so very powerful. That basically keeps the image constant when you're driving inside, which is one of the main things I made this vehicle to do. Oh, also I forgot to mention that the total price for these parts over here, if we just go like this, there we go, total price $590. This is using the separate gears times 8, and this is a cheaper option. The proper way to do it would be to use the custom gears, which would be $700, so that would be over $800 just to build these tracks. So onto this again. This is I think I didn't mention this. This is just a display. It's like a 10-inch display that can connect to S-Video, which is output by the receiver of the first-person view system. So a lot larger than regular FPV screens. This is very nice to be able to see great. It's also very thin. This one, this screen display, is actually from Lee's Electronics, which is here in Vancouver. And it's $130 for a pretty nice LCD panel with controller included and everything. And the on-screen display over here would display all the information, such as like the GPS direction, how much current is getting used, although I'm not sure if this would be a good option, because it can only measure up to 80 amps, and the tracked vehicle can do 2 times 120 amps max, which is 240 amps, and that would be a lot more than that, so probably wouldn't want to have a current sensor there, it might get fried or something. Over here we've got FPV camera. This isn't particularly a one that I would get. There are quite a few options. Some are cheaper than others. And yeah, basically just have to experiment. I'm not really familiar with all these cameras, and I just have to find the right one that has good image quality, that's not really expensive. Fiberglass pan tilt camera mount. This is actually made for the Sony sensor that comes in this kit. And this would go inside this dome over here. I haven't put in that pan tilt thing, but I do have the camera sensor in there, so that's where it would be located. This dome over here is from a regular security camera, which I have. Then we got some cyclic servos. That's for the pan tilt camera mount, because that doesn't come with servos. 900 megahertz polarized antennas. These are the really big antennas for this 900 megahertz system, And did I not put one on this? No, I guess I didn't. When I first built this model, I put the antenna on it, but I guess I forgot to on this one. It's over here, so you can just stick it on wherever it's more convenient for you. It's this thing, and made that myself. I think it looks pretty close to the real one. But yeah, it's a big antenna. It's like 20 centimeters in diameter or something for a strong reception. Actually, this, yeah, sending and reception. And we got some extension cables for the antenna, low pass filter, so that you get some better signal, less interference with the system. And then a wide angle lens, 150 degrees. This is something I don't have on that camera I'm using right now. It would really help to be able to drive a tank like this with an onboard camera with a wide angle lens so you can see more to the sides. And the total for this FPV system would be about $500. So that's all the parts, and I'll quickly give you guys one last look at the tank over here, robot thingy. So we've got the motors at the back there with the gearboxes, and I think they're a bit too close together. They're a bit overlapping. I didn't actually make the model for these motors. I just downloaded it from the SketchUp Workshop, so I'm not sure if they're exactly to size, but I did make the gearboxes exactly the size. These are pretty accurate, I think. And over here we've got the transmitter with some thin cables going to it. These are like half a millimeter apart, so SketchUp had some trouble sort of making like rounded corners and stuff, so I just went with straight single lines for this very tight stuff there. Got the cables that go up to the external antenna. This is a big metal box and it would have a metal lid on it, so sort of like a Faraday cage, this would get barely any reception, and that's why you want to have this antenna on the exterior. This is the Spectrum, I think 6200 receiver or something similar to that. Basically, that's connected to the BEC, and then the channels for driving this are connected to the Sabertooth motor controller here, and that's connected to power. So all these power cables go where they need, the ones that go to the motor, the ones that go to power, and the ones over here, which come from the battery, also go off to the BEC, and they go off this way to the video transmitter. I haven't actually hooked up the cables to this yet. This one goes to the antenna, and these cables go to the camera. And the camera also needs power, so it's not completely finished, but pretty much most of the stuff is done. Here you can have the battery with a Traxxas connector over here, which goes to the plug. I mean the switch. So we've got a big power switch over here, and then that goes off to all the electronics. So one power switch turns off on and off everything, just disconnects the battery. This is a big 21.5 milliamp hour lead acid battery, which I already have in my current robot. It's really heavy. I'm not sure if I would want to have it in this. It might make it difficult to move around or climb over stuff. But yeah, I could always switch it to a LiPo battery, and that would also give higher amperage output for these motors, which draw quite a lot of current. And that would actually be an improvement if I had some LiPo batteries instead of a big lead acid battery, since I think they're limited to about, most of them I think are less than 100 amps. But there are some that are over, not completely sure. Overall, this is the main look of the thing without the tracks and without the lid on top. So, yeah, smaller, more compact, and, basically, a better design in general of the track vehicle. The first one, I didn't even have a model for it. I just drew something and built it, eyeballing stuff and just using the ruler. Here, I'm actually going through stuff pretty accurately to millimeters and just making sure that everything is perfect. And then maybe in the future, you guys will see a video where I actually start building this thing, when I have money. So, parts are here. If you want to build your own stuff and or just take a look at this, links are all in the description so you can download the stuff you want. And that's going to be it. So thank you guys for watching. If you have any ideas, stuff that you'd like to see me add to this, I'm open to new suggestions. Or if you just want to download it and add your own, maybe build yourself something similar, go for it. So thank you guys for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.